Hank Ramirez. What's up, guys? How are you tonight? Let's grab our Bibles, go to Romans 11. And let me ask, how many of you, see your hands, have ever had somebody important to you make a promise to you that they didn't keep? I would venture to say it's almost all of us. And if this were a classroom a little bit smaller, I would ask, share with us not who or what, but how it made you feel. And I'll never forget, I had a student one time say, I felt like my guts had been cut out of my body and stomped on. And it's often things like that, you know. How would it be if God made promises to you and he didn't keep them? How would that be? How about a promise like Romans 8, the end of the chapter? Convinced neither height nor depth, angels, principality, powers, things present, things to come, nor any other created thing will be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. What if God broke that promise? It'd be a big deal, wouldn't it? Well, the interesting thing is that God has made some very interesting promises, a lot like that, to Israel. And yet in Paul's day, it looked like God had taken Israel and set her aside, rejected her, and that he was still working with what was almost exclusively, not exclusively, but almost a Gentile thing called the church. Romans 9, 10, and 11, among other things, is about whether or not God is keeping his promises to Israel. And the answer is, yes, he is keeping his promises to Israel. We're going to see that further unpacked tonight in Romans chapter 11. So you guys have outlines. Here's our big idea for the night, for this section, in verses 1 through 10. Paul makes three statements affirming the fact that God is not finished yet with Israel, that he has not cast her off and ultimately rejected her. And so there's really just two main sections to our discussion tonight, verses 1 through 10. Paul asks in verse 1 and answers the question, has God rejected Israel? And Paul will say, no. And then he will indicate in what way, what proof there is that God hasn't rejected Israel. And then in verses 11 to 36, he'll ask and answer a second question. Did Israel stumble in order that they might fall? That is Israel lost forever? This is capital B in your outline on the first page. And again, the answer is no. And then what Paul will do in verses 11 to 36 is to show you how it is that Israel is someday going to come back to Jesus. So that's where we're going to go. Three statements here. Verses 1 through 10, affirming the fact God's not finished yet with Israel. Here's the first one, statement number one. God just hasn't rejected Israel. He just says it straight out. Verse 1. I ask then, has God rejected his people? By no means. For I myself am an Israelite, a descendant of Abraham, a member of the tribe of Benjamin. God has not rejected his people whom he foreknew. Do you not know what the scriptures say of Elijah, how he appeals to God against Israel? We'll come back to that in a second. So I want you to notice here that Paul says, first of all, exhibit A on the idea that God has just thrown Israel away and is no longer interested in her and is just working with the church. He says, I'm exhibit A. Look at me. I'm a Jew. And I believe in Jesus. I am proof that God is not done with Israel yet. By the way, I just want to say, the vast majority of what we would call New Testament churches today in our country and around the world, and the vast majority of evangelical scholars believe that God is done with Israel. And by the way, when we're talking about Israel, we mean Israel not just as an ethnic people, but as a nation as well. And we'll see that in a little bit. Here's the second statement Paul makes. God has reserved a remnant, the end of verse 2 through verse 6. And he uses an illustration of Elijah, the prophet in the Old Testament. So he says at the end of verse 2, "Do you not know what the scripture says of Elijah, how he appeals to God against Israel? Lord, they have killed your prophets, they have demolished your altars, and I alone am left, and they seek my life. But what is God's reply to him? I have kept for myself 7,000 men who have not bowed the knee to Baal." Now you should go back and read through that section. It's really interesting. Comes in 1 Kings chapter 19. And three times, God asks Elijah, "What are you doing here? What are you doing here?" By the way, where's here? Elijah starts way up at Mount Carmel. By the way, I just got to say this. You're going to laugh when I say this. If you come with me to Israel in June of 2025, there's a harvest tour that's planned. We have drivers and guides and hotels. We have everything reserved. We discovered very recently that if we were to go in 2 weeks, there's a lot of openings there in Israel right now. So, in June of 2025, we're scheduled. We'll see if it happens. But if you were to come with me, he deals with the prophets of Baal, Elijah does, in Mount Carmel, which is kind of up north. And then it says he goes down to Beersheba. And then it says he goes 2 weeks south of Beersheba. And you know, if he goes 2 weeks south of Beersheba, which is sort of toward the southern side of Israel, you know where you end up? You end up on the Sinai Peninsula. And it says in 1 Kings that Elijah goes to Mount Horeb, which is another name for Mount Sinai. And what is he doing? He thinks he's the next Moses. But God asks him, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" It's a rebuke. When Elijah left Israel, Israel was left without a prophet. God didn't want him down there. He goes down there on his own accord, thinking, "I'm going to be the next Moses." He goes to the mountain of Moses. He hides in the cleft of the rock, which is the same cave Moses was hidden in by God when God passed by him in Exodus chapter 34. He thinks he's a new Moses. And so God says, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" Elijah says, "Lord, they've killed your prophets. They demolished your altars. I alone am left." See, he has an overinflated view of himself. Elijah does at this point. "And they're seeking to kill my life." And God says to him, "I have kept for myself 7,000 men who have not bowed the knee to Baal." And then he goes on, Paul does in verse 5 and 6, and shows why Elijah's relevant for him. He says, "So too, at the present time," this is true not just for Elijah, that God has kept a remnant, "there is a remnant chosen by grace. But if it's by grace, it's no longer on the basis of works. Otherwise, grace would no longer be grace." And so what we have in Elijah's day, the vast majority of Israel was terribly apostate, had wandered into idolatry. But God had kept 7,000 men, and there were probably women and children aside from that, who God had preserved, faithful to himself. And Elijah, who thought he was the only one, gets schooled here. God's kept more. And so that was true in Paul's day as well. Here's the point. God has always kept for himself a faithful remnant from among the broader group of ethnic Israel. In chapter 9, you saw that it was Isaac, not Ishmael, who was chosen by God, both descendants of Abraham. It was Jacob, not Esau, both of them having the same mothers. They're twins, but God had chosen Jacob and not Esau. "Jacob I love, but Esau I Jacob I love, but Esau I... And we evangelicals gag on the word. Esau I hated. And by hated, God means I've chosen not to choose him. He's set aside. He's not going to enjoy the blessings of the Abrahamic covenant like Jacob is, which includes salvation, God's decision. So God is continuing to do with Israel what he's always done. Select out of his sovereignty some Jewish people, like Paul, to be saved. And the rest are hardened. And I know Pastor Jeff walked you guys through Romans chapter 9. It's really good that he did. And I know he does a great job with that. So it's by grace. There's a remnant chosen by grace. But if it's by grace, it's no longer on the basis of works. Otherwise, grace would no longer be grace. That is, God chooses people to be saved. And we have to have faith too. We have to have faith. But God chooses us on the basis of his kindness, and thus we get saved. Okay, you guys with me so far? Here's the second statement, or the third statement, rather. God has hardened the nation, verses 7 through 10. It talks about the fact of the hardening and the support for the hardening, verse 7. What then? Israel failed to obtain what it was seeking. What was it seeking? A righteous status and acceptance before God. The elect obtained it. That's because God chose them and they had faith. But the rest were hardened. And again, we evangelicals look at this whole idea, this whole concept of God hardening people, and it just freaks us out. But I'm here to tell you, it's all over the Bible. It's everywhere. So much more to say about that. But I know, again, Pastor Jeff walked you through that. And so you shouldn't have any more questions. There should be no more mystery here on this at all. So, yeah. So, as it is written, verse 8, God gave them a spirit of stupor, eyes that they would not see and ears that would not hear, down to this very day. And David says, let their table become a snare and a trap, a stumbling block and a retribution for them. Let their eyes be darkened so they cannot see and bend their backs forever. When it says here that God gave them a spirit of stupor, that's a citation of Isaiah 29:10. That is a citation from the prophets. Eyes to see not, down to this very day, cites Deuteronomy 29 and verse 4 from the Torah, from the Pentateuch. And then verse 9 cites Psalm 69, 22, and 23, lest their table become a snare and a trap. And so what you have here is a citation from Paul from all three major sections of the Old Testament, from the Pentateuch, the law, the prophets, the writings, the Psalms, that God periodically in history has hardened his people. And we're going to see in a second why he's done that. But Paul's point once again is that this is what God's always done with Israel. He's always done this, indicating that even in Paul's day, even though it looks like he might have thrown Israel away, he has not. He was continuing to do with her what he had always done with her. And let me just stop here and just say, before we go on, why does this matter? This is all about Israel. I want to hear about church. The passage is about Israel. It's not exactly about church. But I want to come back to what I started with. If God is not keeping promises to Israel, there's no guarantee he'll keep them to us. And so it's actually really important for us to establish the fact, one more time, that God is keeping his promises to Israel, and he will keep his promises to us in Christ as well. Because God is a promise-keeping God. Now, that wouldn't have been a bad place for an amen. But you missed it. You missed the opportunity. It's all gone. It's just gone. All right. Here's the second big question Paul asks and answers in this passage, spanning verses 11 to 36. And that is Israel lost forever? Take a look at verse 11. Well, let's read our thesis first, our idea for this section. In spite of God's obvious emphasis on the Gentiles and the church during the present age, Paul maintains adamantly that God is not done with the Jewish people and the nation of Israel. Paul presents four stages in the relationship of Gentile and Jewish salvation, indicating that the Jews have not been lost forever. So now we see how it is God's going to bring about Israel's restoration, and it's really interesting. There's this back and forth thing that happens. Just a forecast. Israel gets saved. So you got a bunch of Jews. Like, you got the disciples. You got the Jerusalem church, right? You have them expanding a little bit into the Mediterranean world. So you have Jews getting saved first. Then a bunch of Gentiles get saved. Then Israel becomes hardened. Then the hardening is going to be lifted off of Israel eventually. And then a bunch of more Gentiles are going to be saved. There's this back and forth kind of thing, how God is determined he's going to be bringing about Israel's salvation. So let's start at verse 11. Paul says, "So I ask, did they stumble in order that they might fall?" The stumbling here refers to sort of a permanent, sort of a trip so that there's a permanent loss of Israel in God's program. And that's the fall. Did they stumble and are they done now? By no means, he says. Rather, through their trespass, salvation has come to the Gentiles so as to make Israel jealous. So just follow me for a second. When John the Baptist and Jesus first show up, what's their message? It's to Israel. Repent, for what's at hand? Kingdom of God, kingdom of heaven is at hand. What if Israel would have wholeheartedly and in totality repented then? In theory, on a human level, there would not have been time for the Gentiles to have been enfolded and to have embraced Christ and get saved. So one of the purposes is that God hardens Israel to allow time for the gospel to get to the Gentile people. So, their trespass, that is Israel's lack of faith, because through their trespass, salvation has come to the Gentiles so as to make Israel jealous. The word jealous actually means, see if I can find it here. It means to provoke someone, in this case the Jewish people, to provoke them to become intensely zealous for what is rightfully theirs. Okay? It's not just jealousy, but it's to provoke a person to intense concern for what is rightly his or hers. And so all of a sudden now, there's all these Gentiles who are embracing the Jewish Messiah. By the way, I gotta say this, guys. You guys have to get a feel for this. The fact that we are here in North America, in Chicago, sort of, and we as Gentiles have embraced the Messiah of the Jews is, you got to hear everything I'm about to say, it's weird. It's wonderfully weird. Praise Jesus. But it's weird, guys. Paul's going to say later, it's contrary to nature. And yet this is God's plan. It was always God's plan in the Old Testament over and over and over again. God forecast that his kingdom was going to have Israel at the hub, but that all the nations of the world were going to be blessed. All the nations of the world were going to be blessed and rightly related to him. That's always been his plan with his kingdom. And we're seeing that at this time. Now, verse 12, if their trespass means riches for the world and their failure means riches for the Gentiles, how much more will their full inclusion mean? That is, when Israel finally gets restored in right relationship with God, there's going to be something extraordinary happens. We're talking about virtually all of the Jewish people and the nation of Israel as well. Verse 13, now I'm speaking to you Gentiles, inasmuch as I'm an apostle to the Gentiles, I magnify my ministry in order to somehow make my fellow Jews jealous, there's that word again, and thus save some of them. For if their rejection means the reconciliation of the world, remember, they rejected the Lord right now. And because they rejected the Lord and God's hardened her, both are true. She's rejected and God's hardened her. But it allows time for the Gentiles to come. But someday, as we're going to see in verse 26, all Israel will be saved. And when that happens, it's going to be glorious for the entire planet when that happens. And so verse 15, if their rejection of Jesus means the reconciliation of the world, what will their acceptance mean but life from the dead? Okay, I want to go on here. We'll talk about that in just a second. That sounds like resurrection. It probably isn't, and I'll tell you why in a second. But I want to tell you a story about jealousy and envy and provoking somebody to be intensely interested in what belongs to them. My friend Michael Ray Delnick has another friend, and this is a true story, Michael tells me. Michael's friend had a dog, and the dog had bad habits of eating things that shouldn't eat, and it got really super sick. So the guy took his dog to the vet, and the dog was there for like a week, and it was sort of touch and go for a while, but after a while, the vet was able to help the dog pull through, and the dog was okay. So the guy took the dog home, but the dog just wouldn't eat, and was kind of getting more weak and more lethargic. And so this guy prepared food for a dog that no dog could really resist, you know, I mean, like chicken and tacos and syrup and stuff, you know, just to make it so it's really good. The dog's not interested. One day, and it was summer, the guy had the kitchen window open. The dog's food dish was in the kitchen. And the neighbor's cat jumped into the window, onto the counter, onto the floor, and walked over to the dog's food and started to eat it. And the dog was just sort of laying there and went. And just this motion kind of spooked the cat, so the cat went away. But the cat knew he could find food there, so the next day the cat came back. Went over and ate. Dog reacted again. Cat got spooked. One more day, cat came, started to eat. The dog this time got up, spooked the cat, went over and began to eat his food. Now, we Gentile cats, I'm thinking of hippies, right? We Gentile cats, you know, yeah, I know you're too young for that, sorry. We Gentile cats, we get to enjoy what's really ultimately, initially, especially intended for Israel. But the idea is that Israel will wake up and go, you know, all these Gentiles are enjoying our Messiah. Come on. We gotta go. By the way, one of the best ways I've been told by a Jewish believer lives in Israel, one of the best ways to show and to encourage people in Israel to trust Jesus is for us to go over there and spend our money. So that really means a lot to them if we do that. So that's my application here, is to go on the tour to Israel, right? So, all right, so what about this life from the dead? It says in verse, you know, what will their acceptance be? That is, when they accept Jesus again, it'll be life from the dead. Well, again, it sounds like resurrection, but probably not. Paul uses a similar expression in two places in Romans before this. And you don't have to turn there, but Romans 4:17. God is speaking to Abraham. I have made you a father of many nations in the presence of God in whom he believed. God who gives life to the dead and calls into existence things that do not exist. That's talking about Abraham's ability to father children. And then in Romans 6:13, Paul says, do not present your members to sin as instruments for unrighteousness, but present yourselves to God as those who have been brought from death to life, or being made alive from the dead, according to the NASB. And so we have similar expressions here. And I think the idea is that when Israel embraces their Messiah, there's going to be this enormous outbreak of spiritual revivification for the entire planet. Now, the Old Testament is full of places where it talks about how it is that when Israel gets right with God, the nations of the world will see it and embrace God as well. And I think that's what Paul is talking about here. Three passages, and there's dozens of them in the Old Testament. I'll read three. You don't have to turn to these. This is Psalm 102, verses 13 to 15. Notice, Israel gets saved first, then the nations of the world. Psalm 102, 13 to 15, you will arise and have pity on Zion, referring to God. It is time to favor her. The appointed time has come. For your servants hold her stones dear and have pity on her dust. Nations will fear the name of the Lord, and all the kings of the earth will fear your glory when God arises and has mercy on Israel. That has to happen first. Ezekiel 36, 23, God says, I will vindicate the holiness of my great name, which has been profaned among the nations and which you have profaned among them. And the nations will know that I am the Lord, declares the Lord God, when through you I vindicate my holiness before their eyes. And then verse 33, thus says the Lord God, on the day that I cleanse you from all your iniquities, I will cause the cities to be inhabited, and the waste places shall be rebuilt. Then verse 36, then the nations that are left all around you shall know that I am the Lord. I have rebuilt the ruined places and replanted that which was desolate. I am the Lord. I have spoken. I will do it. Notice the order. Israel first, then the nations. And Paul's talking about that here. Isaiah 27, verse 6. In days to come, Jacob shall take root. Israel shall blossom and put forth shoots and fill the whole world with fruit. And Isaiah 27 is about Israel's future restoration before God. That when Israel is restored, she'll put out shoots and fill the whole world with fruit. Do you ever wonder why it is in Matthew chapter 10, Jesus says to the disciples when he sends them out, don't go to the Gentiles, go to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Do you know why? Because if Israel gets saved first, then the whole world follows. Do you ever notice, if you read through Acts chapter 10, the apostle Peter is witnessing to Cornelius, and he says several times that Jesus sent them to the people of Israel, that Jesus came to the people of Israel, that the disciples initially went to the people of Israel. He says that three or four times in that passage. Do you know why they went first to the people of Israel? And unfortunately, there are some evangelicals here who say it's because the disciples were racists against Gentiles. I'm thinking, well, if they were racists against Gentiles, so was Jesus. Well, that's not it. It's because those men knew that if Israel gets straightened out, the whole world is straightened out. So you focus on that at first. And then God says, no, time to go to the Gentiles. And so we see that reflected here in verse 15. For if their rejection means the reconciliation of the world, that is, we're coming to Jesus now because they've rejected Christ and God's hardened them, what will their acceptance be when they accept Jesus? But life from the dead is going to have an enormous impact on the whole world. All right, so Israel's Gentile salvation provokes Israel's jealousy. And then number two, Israel's blessings provide Gentile salvation. Verses 16 to 24. Verse 16, if the dough offered as first fruits is holy, so is the whole lump. And if the root is holy, so are the branches. But if some of the branches were broken off, and you, although a wild olive shoot, were grafted in among the others, and now share in the nourishing root of the olive tree, we'll stop there. So what do all these mean? So the holy root is probably the same thing as the dough. Roots, typically, as you look at it, roots go first, and then the plant pops up. There has to be some roots first, or at least that's how it looks. When they made bread back then, they would take dough, and they would make a batch. They would insert yeast into it, and it would leaven, but they'd pull a piece of dough that had active yeast in it, set it aside, and then they would use that for the next batch. And so we have this little thing that's going to influence a big thing later. And so what is the little thing that later influences the big thing? Best answer here, and I'm just going to give you my conclusions, is that what we're talking about is that the first little piece of dough, that little thing, is a reference to the patriarchs. The root is also a reference to the patriarchs. And this is why I say that. Skip down to verse 28. It says, as regards the gospel, they are enemies for your sake, but as regards election, they are beloved for the sake of their forefathers. For the gifts and the calling of God are irrevocable. Now, our charismatic friends will say, that's speaking in tongues. It's still in the church today. But in context, the better understanding is that the gifts and the calling of God here refer to God's promised covenant blessings made to Israel, but that would incorporate the Gentiles as well. So as regards election, they're beloved for the sake of the forefathers, that is the patriarchs. And so because of the promises God made to the patriarchs, later Israel will be holy. Verse 17, if some of the branches were broken off, and you, although a wild olive shoot, were grafted in among the others and now share in the nourishing root of the olive tree, do not be arrogant toward the branches. If you are, remember it is not you who support the root, but the root that supports you. Now, I don't understand why it is, but in every evangelical church I've been in, including Harvest Bible Chapel, there have always been evangelical Christians who were racist against the Jews, in every church I've been in. Negative comments about them. There's a mounting feeling today of anti-Israel sentiment. I don't know if you guys have noticed that with what's going on there in the Middle East. And I understand it. Just last night on the news, you know, I was watching and there were three Israeli IDF soldiers who put on a disguise of Palestinians and went into a hospital to kill some really high up Hamas leaders. And of course, then they interviewed a person who said, well, according to international law, that's a war crime. And I'm thinking, did the man who make that comment also understand that for them to hide in a hospital is a war crime? You never hear about that. And so let me just say this. Part of evangelicalism means that unless there is clear and objective proof that Israel has done something sinful, our predisposition should be to support Israel and not to become critical of her. And way too many evangelicals are starting to, and I'm just thinking that's really sad. You know what's gonna happen? There's a ceasefire, right? If there's gonna be a ceasefire, and they want a ceasefire for like, I don't know, 6 months or something now. So in other words, basically they want Israel to surrender to Hamas. That's what they're asking Israel to do. I think maybe if the world asked Hamas to surrender to Israel, the killing would stop very quickly, don't you think? And so it's just, everything's messed up. Have you guys ever noticed how the world hates Israel? And there's a theological reason for that. It's not just racism. There's a theological reason for it. What God loves, the world hates. God loves us, the church. The world is getting more and more to hate us. Have you noticed that? Same thing with Israel. Well, I have wasted way too much time here. No, I'm not fine. I'm going to be, I'll get a note from somebody here, so. You can send it to jesmith@harvestbiblechapel.com. In verse 24, it says, "For if you are cut off, cut from what is by nature a wild olive tree and grafted contrary to nature into a cultivated olive tree, how much more will these, the natural branches, be grafted back into their own olive tree?" You might have taken, back in those days, branches from a healthy cultivated olive tree and grafted them into a wild olive tree, because the amazing thing is, even though they're grafted into the trunk or the other branches of the wild olive tree, by the time the sap gets done flowing through there, the olives that are produced off of the branch from a good tree are good olives. They're not wild olives. It's really kind of interesting. But nobody is going to take a branch from a wild olive tree and graft it into a cultivated one, because you'll get wild olives. Nobody's going to do that. It's contrary to nature. And yet, what has God done? He's taken us, and he's grafted us not into Israel. We do not become Jews, by the way. The wild branches remain wild branches here. They don't turn into cultivated branches. They remain wild branches. But the deal is that we as Gentiles get to enjoy the same sort of fatness of the root, the promises made to the patriarchs that the Jewish people enjoy, which includes salvation from sins, being declared righteous by God, that we enjoy those too as we have faith in Messiah. Well, we'll go very quickly now and just talk about some happy things. Verse 25, "Lest you be wise in your own sight, I do not want you to be unaware of this mystery, things not seen in the Old Testament. A partial hardening has come upon Israel, that is, part of Israel has been hardened." Paul wasn't hardened. The followers of Jesus weren't hardened, but the others were. It's not a permanent thing. If they come to Christ, they'll be forgiven. "Partial hardening has come upon Israel until the fullness of the Gentiles has come in." A bunch of Gentiles are going to get saved. "And in this way," that is, Jews get saved, then a bunch of Gentiles, then Israel gets hardened, and then a bunch of Gentiles get saved, then Israel gets restored to the Lord, and the more Gentiles after that, that whole thing, most all of that is a mystery in the Old Testament. You don't see all of those stages. "But in this way," as we just described these stages, "all Israel will be saved. As it is written, the deliverer will come from Zion. He will banish ungodliness from Jacob. And this will be my covenant with them when I take away their sins." All Israel is used 150 times in the Old Testament. Paul's probably using it the same way. Every time it's used, it refers to a select group, could be a pretty large group, but a group of Jewish people in the context. The Bible says that all Israel came to bury Samuel. All Israel saw Rehoboam and Jeroboam begin to sort of argue with each other. All Israel saw that. Well, it doesn't mean every single Jew. It's a large representation of the Jewish people saw these things. And so eventually, there's going to be a huge representation of Jewish people, enough that Paul could say all Israel will be saved. And notice it's all Israel will be saved, not all the Jews will be saved. There's a national component here too. Verse 28, "As regards the gospel, they are enemies for your sake." By the way, the end of verse 25 says a partial hardening has come upon Israel until the fullness of the Gentiles has come in. "And in this way, all Israel will be saved." A lot of scholars say, well, Israel and all Israel, verse 25, 26, that's the church. That the church is going to be saved in this way. The problem is it can't be the church. Look in verse 28. "As it regards the gospel, they are enemies for your sake." Is the church the enemy of the church? Sometimes. But not really. And so as regards the gospel, they, Israel, are enemies for your sake. But as regards election, they're beloved for the sake of their forefathers. That is, because God's chosen them and made promises to them about the future. It's not going to be like this forever. The gifts and the calling of God are irrevocable. God will someday save the Jewish people, just like he has Gentiles. Verse 30, just as you, Gentiles, at one time were disobedient to God, but now have received mercy because of their disobedience, so they too have now been disobedient in order by the mercy shown to you, they also may now receive mercy. That's the back and forth thing that we've been talking about. For God has consigned all to disobedience that he may have mercy on all. This means all kinds of people, Jews and Gentiles, not every single human on the planet, absolutely. And then verses 33 to 36, there's a great, great eulogy there, a doxology. So, by the way, Pastor Jeff, when he was really new here, preached verses 33 to 36 and did a brilliant job of it. You should go online and see if you can find that, because it's really good. All right, here's my application. Let me see if I can find it. Number one, if you harbor negative thoughts about the Jewish people and Israel, unless there's clear evidence. By the way, you are getting slanted things in the liberal press. Of course, you knew I would say that. You knew I would say that. If you want to get a good, accurate view of what's really going on, there's a website called The Times of Israel. The Times of Israel. It would be worth, if you are interested in what's going on in Israel, it'd be worth for you to load that up on your computer and go to it. The Times of Israel. And you'll get a good, accurate account. So I just want to suggest that if you harbor negative thoughts about the Jewish people, this is racism, stop it. I've had people in other churches say, Jews, God doesn't love them, he's done with them, they're Christ killers. It's a typical Jewish slam. Oh yeah, the Jews, they own all the money in the world. Most of my Jewish friends would say, not so much, you know. And so if you harbor negative thoughts about the Jewish people in Israel, this racism, and you need to stop. Paul says it here, commands you, don't be arrogant. Second, the correct evangelical position is to be supportive of Israel unless she is clearly sinning. And I don't really think she is. You have to remember that all these people have died in Gaza because Hamas is using them as human shields, a huge war crime. And you hear some of that discussed, but I don't think people really get it. They still think that Israel is evil here. By the way, Israel gets accused of being involved in genocide. I would urge all of you to Google sometime the Hamas Constitution, where three times it says that the ultimate goal of Hamas is the elimination of Israel. Three times it says that. Anybody's involved in genocide, it's them, it's not Israel. Hamas Constitution, Google it, read it, you'll see it. I was astonished when I saw it. Last thing, tell your Jewish friends how indebted we Christians are to Israel and the Jewish people, how the roots of our religion are embedded in their soil. Use that to build a bridge to any Jewish friends and acquaintances you might have a chance to talk to. It'll tickle them. It'll give them pleasure to hear you say that. Let's pray. So, Heavenly Father, lot of stuff here. You know, you chose Israel to be at the center of your program. In the past, in the present, Israel is hardened, the majority of her, and you're focusing upon the church, and yet the church is also the initial manifestation of your kingdom, which has and will have Israel at the hub. So, Father, we are thrilled to hear that someday all Israel will be saved. We know that you are keeping your promises to the Jewish people, even though it doesn't really look that way. And we're really grateful for that, Father, because it means you'll keep your promises to us too, because that's just who you are. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.